meet Logan, a freshman starting college. In the first week, he studied 2 hours for his calculus quiz, scored a 70, and slept about 8 hours a night. In the second week, he ramped up to 5 hours of studying and scored a 90, but his sleep dropped to around 7 hours a night. By week three, Logan was putting in 6 hours of study time and scored a 95, but now he was down to 6.5 hours of sleep. See the pattern? What if we plot the data this way? Do you see it now? More studying, higher scores, but also more studying, less sleep. Some data values move together, others in opposite directions. We want a way to measure the relationship, not just notice it, quantify it. That measurement is called covariance. It's a way to put a number on how two variables move together. Positive covariance means they rise and fall together. Negative covariance means they move in opposite directions. No clear pattern, the covariance will be close to zero. So in the case of our friend Logan, his study time and quiz scores have a positive covariance. But sadly, the covariance between his study time and hours of sleep is negative. Now in Logan's example, the relationships are clear. Study more, score higher, study more, sleep less. But when you're analyzing big data, it's rarely that obvious. You're often dealing with millions or billions of observations, where trends are hidden in the noise. And not all relationships are equal. Some are subtle, some are strong, and we need a way to measure that too. That's where the formula for covariance comes in. It gives us a precise way to quantify these relationships, even when they're not obvious at first glance. Is it even possible to quantify our relationship with our patrons on Patreon? They make our work possible in so many ways. Join them at patreon.com/socratica. When you're working with just a handful of points, it's easy to spot patterns, but real-world data rarely makes it that easy. It's noisy, full of outliers and overlapping effects that obscure what you're looking for. Finance is a classic example. There's no shortage of data, daily prices, volumes, volatility, and an endless search for relationships worth acting on. Take Google and Meta. Both are large tech companies, both in the same sector. You might expect their performance to be related, but what does that mean in practice? Instead of focusing on the raw price of each stock, which is scale dependent and dominated by long-term trends, analysts look at the percent change in price from one day to the next. That's called the return. So we might try graphing the daily returns for both companies. They're a bit chaotic. The patterns you saw in the price charts seem to have disappeared. Here's the real issue. These charts show how each stock moves over time, but what we actually care about is how they move with respect to each other. So, to better see the relationship, we plot one return versus the other. Here's a scatter plot of daily returns for Google and Meta during 2017 and 2018. Each dot is a trading day. When Meta had a good day, Google usually did too. When Meta dropped, Google often followed. The dots cluster from the lower left to the upper right, a clear directional trend. Now compare that to SPY and VIXY. SPY tracks the S&P 500, VIXY tracks volatility, and it tends to rise when markets fall. When we scatter their returns against each other, the pattern flips. This time, the dots stretch from upper left to lower right. When SPY falls, VIXY rises. That's an inverse relationship. These tilted clouds, up and to the right, down and to the right, are the kinds of patterns covariance is designed to measure. Covariance gives us a number that captures the overall direction of that spread. Positive, negative, or none at all, that number tells us how two variables move together. Imagine we have two sequences of data, which we'll call X and Y, recorded over the same period. We want to know if these two variables covary, that is, if they tend to move together. When we say covary, we mean are they above or below their respective averages at the same time. For each pair of points, we look at how much each value deviates from its mean, that is, we subtract the mean from each value, we then multiply these deviations together. Here's why that matters. If both values are above average, the deviations are positive. Multiply them, and the product is positive. That's a positive contribution to the covariance. Same thing if both are below average. The deviations are negative, but their product is still positive. They're moving together. But if one value is above average and the other is below, the product is negative. That pulls the covariance down. So each pair of points gives us a product that tells us whether they're moving together or in opposite directions. The more they move together, the more of these products are positive. If they mostly move in opposite directions, the negatives start to dominate. There's one final step. We take the average of all those products to get one number, one measurement. That's the formula for the covariance. Let's use this formula to calculate the covariance by hand. We've got two tiny data sets, and we'll call them A and B. They each have just five values. It's very important that you remember that these data values occur together. Can you remember that? The scatter plot for these five pairs of numbers shows a clear positive relationship, but we want a specific covariance value. To calculate the covariance, we first find the means of each data set. Now for each pair, we calculate how far each number is from its mean. In other words, the deviations. Each product tells us something about how that pair moves. If the product is positive, they move together. A negative product means they move apart. There's not a single negative product in this data set. Makes you think, doesn't it? And lastly, take the average of the five products. Our covariance for the two data sets is 6.8. Positive, 6.8. It tells us A and B tend to rise and fall together. Okay, so we got a covariance of 6.8. But is that big? Is it small? Is it impressive? Honestly, it's hard to say. Covariance doesn't have a built-in scale. Its size depends entirely on the units and the spread of your variables. Let's say we were tracking heights and weights. If you measured height in meters, the covariance might be 60, but switch meters to centimeters, suddenly the covariance is 6,000. Same data, same relationship, completely different value. Why? Because covariance is sensitive to scale. Multiply every x value by 5, and the covariance grows by a factor of 5. Multiply every y value by 7, and the covariance grows by a factor of 7. Scale both together, and now the covariance isn't just a bit bigger, it's 35 times bigger. That means you can't compare covariances across datasets unless the variables are on the same scale. A covariance of 20 might be huge in one context, tiny in another. This makes covariance great for detecting the direction of a relationship, positive or negative, but not so great for comparing the strength of different relationships. That's where correlation comes in. It takes the covariance and normalizes it, squashes it down into a number between negative 1 and 1, but we'll save that story for another video. While covariance isn't ideal for comparing across datasets, it continues to play a key role in data analysis. It's true that covariance values shift with scale, but the relationships they reveal don't disappear. Covariance isn't simply a mathematical curiosity. Whether you're analyzing markets, machines, or models, covariance quietly powers some of the most important decisions in data science. In finance, covariance helps investors build smarter portfolios. If two assets tend to move together, then you'll likely gain or lose money in both assets at the same time. To reduce your risk, it's better to spread your money around. So if one asset does poorly, another may do well. It's even better if your assets are independent of each other. That's diversification, and covariance is how we measure it. In physics and engineering, covariance shows up when you're dealing with quantities that interact, like temperature and pressure in a gas, or speed and angle in a robotic system. These aren't isolated measurements. They co-vary, and understanding that relationship helps you model, control, and predict how the system behaves. In machine learning, covariance helps us understand the structure of our data, how different features relate to each other. When you have a data set with lots of variables, you want to know which ones tend to move together. That's where covariance comes in. It reveals patterns of dependency and overlap. This is especially useful in techniques like PCA, principal component analysis, which simplifies complex datasets by identifying new directions where the data varies the most. It's a common way to reduce complexity without losing the essence of the data. So far, we've looked at just two variables at a time, but what if you're working with 10 or 100? You don't just want a single covariance, you want to see all the pairwise relationships. For every pair of variables, you can calculate a covariance, just like we did before. If you lay out all those values in a grid, you get something that shows the full structure of how your data moves. We call this the covariance matrix. Along the diagonal, you'll see variances and how each variable varies on its own. Everywhere else, covariances, how each pair of variables moves together. It's a way to hold the entire web of relationships in a single object. The covariance matrix might just look like a table of numbers now, but the more data you work with, the more you'll appreciate what it's really telling you. There's one more relationship we want to highlight, and that's the one we have with you. Every video we make is the result of countless hours of research, writing, editing, and design, and we're able to do it thanks to the ongoing support of our patrons on Patreon. So if you've enjoyed this deep dive into covariance, if you appreciate videos that bring clarity to complex ideas, consider supporting us. Thank you.